Hello and welcome to my presentation about WordPress hosting and scaling in AWS, and thank you for joining. Today we'll show you how we implemented a hosting solution for WordPress on AWS, and furthermore I will show you a demo, a live demo, and on how the system is reacting to a lot of traffic. But before that, I would like to give you a quick introduction about Toscom and myself. Toscom was established in 2003 by Philip Kober as a one-man business, but over the years we grew to currently 12 employees, and we are searching for more Linux and cloud enthusiasts. So if you're looking for a job or know someone who is looking for a job in the Linux and cloud field, feel free to contact us. Currently, we manage over 800 servers and more than 50,000 services on those servers. And our latest achievement was becoming an AWS Select Consulting Partner last year, although we have already several years of AWS experience. But what is Toscom offering to its customers? Well, we are specialized on service and consulting for Linux web servers and open source systems. Linux only, by the way, we don't do Windows workloads. We configure and maintain Linux servers so business have secure and reliable systems. As Max said before, that you can focus on developing and your programming and you don't need to care about hosting. We maintain and set up servers for database solutions, web applications, online shops, and provide high available clusters and cloud solutions. Since you now know what we do, onwards to what I do at Toscom. I studied history and IT management at the University of Vienna, and I'm working in IT since 2014. Currently, I'm the head of operation at Toscom, and I'm an AWS certified solution architect professional since 2020, but I work with AWS since about 6 years. And when I'm not working in IT, I love to hike, although it occurred that I had to combine hiking and IT and debug on calls while being hiking. But now that you know about Toscom and my background, we can head to our architecture followed by a demo. And I hope you enjoy our presentation. Our focus with the upcoming architecture was security first. Furthermore, we needed it to be stable, as in redundant, and in keeping best practices, resilient, as in being able to react to problems or unforeseen events, and cost efficient. In addition, it should be reusable. Therefore, we created our architecture with tools like Ansible, Terraform, and CloudFormation to provide infrastructure as code. This will allow us to have a thorough documentation of the infrastructure, as well as being able to roll it out to multiple identical accounts, not only for WordPress, but for any web application in general. On our next slide, we will take a glance at the technology and hardware we used for this test setup. These are some technical details I will skip over. For the application servers, so where the web server is running and PHP is running, we use T3A large EC2 instances on AWS with 4 cores and 8 GB of RAM. And as the operating system, we use Ubuntu 20.04 LTS. As a web server, we use Apache 2, and we use PHP 7.4. For database, we use AWS Aurora Serverless MySQL 5.7. And one notable WordPress plugin we are kind of fond on right now is VP Rocket, which is a caching plugin. It gave us quite a speed boost the moment we activated it. We use S3 for logging storage, CloudFront as a CDN, an autoscaler, of course, an application load balancer, and an Elastic file system as shared storage for the application servers. Now that we know the key elements of our system, let's head over to the architecture. This diagram does not only look complicated, it is complicated. But I will try to break it down into its various components, and my demo will hopefully bring even more insights to our architecture. Our architecture is quite complex and therefore needs some structure. And AWS organizations gives you the tools to create the structure according to you, or in our case, our needs. On the top part, we see our organization structure. And AWS organizations is a really great and handy tool to create your organizational structure. If you create an AWS account, for example, you want to host your WordPress in AWS, it is tempting to put every resource you create into this account you just created, which is your root account, which is a bad decision. Because putting every resource into your main root account is possible, but it's not best practice and potentially dangerous. The reason for this is, for instance, if you want your staging and production environment, if you have your staging and production environment in one account, those resources could be mixed. Imagine being careless and deleting the wrong database, deleting your production database, for example, or deleting the wrong machine, or deleting the wrong load balancer. So the possibility on mixing up resources and deleting accidentally, wrongfully resources is quite there. If you separate your production and your staging accounts, you can minimize risks like this. Another great tool which organizations is capable of is easier access control. For example, you don't want to give your whole team access to the production account. You don't want your whole team maybe to have access to the logging account, but only a few people for debugging purposes. Another great example for the use of AWS organizations is backups. Imagine your production account gets hacked and the hacker destroys all your resources and your site is not reachable anymore. If you have a separated backup account, you could restore your website fairly easily and won't lose all your data. Another great benefit of using AWS organizations is budget. Budget management gets a lot easier because you avoid spending too much on your staging account, for example, because someone forgot to turn off quite an expensive machine, which can happen fairly easily on AWS. Now that we clarified that we love to use organizations and it's best practice to use organizations, we can head over to our workload. The hosting of WordPress on AWS. The hosting of WordPress in AWS is seen on this part of our diagram. And to clarify this quite complex part of the diagram, we will reach over to how a customer or how a user is being able to reach the website. For example, if you as a user type in staging.toscom.at, you will reach our WordPress right away, which is currently hosted in AWS as a multi setup, as a clustered setup. And how does the user get the content, or how do we in this presentation get the content? Well, first of all, if the user types in staging.toscom.at, his browser or his operating system in this case will reach out to route 53, which will answer the DNS names. In this case, if we ask for staging.toscom.at for the A records, we get our CDN, which is CloudFront, our content delivery service. And the user immediately gets the records from the CloudFront distribution we use. And the CloudFront distribution is storing our static content, like VP content or /VP includes from the web root. So this static content gets delivered quite quickly because CloudFront is using edge locations. So you have multiple locations spread across the globe. So content delivery gets quite a speed boost there. The user, of course, needs to get content back from WordPress itself. We don't only have static content at WordPress. We have PHP in the background, which is hosted at the application backend application servers where the web servers are running as well. And those create the dynamic content we need to deliver from WordPress. So to reach them, the user needs to reach the load balancer, which is hidden behind the CloudFront. The load balancer then decides where to put the request of the user. For example, in this case, let's say the load balancer decides that he wants the user's request to have it in backend applications at this AZ. We'll talk about this a little bit later. So the user then reaches via the load balancer one of the backend application servers. So our request to staging.toscom.at now has reached the backend application servers. There the PHP processes do their thing, and they get database input and the web root from those little icons here. This EFS web root and the Aurora serverless, which is our database, they get shared between every backend application in our system. So every backend application accesses the web root, which is shared on the EFS here, as is the Aurora serverless. So if the backend application machines then work on the dynamic parts of the WordPress and we get an answer from our database, for example, the browser then combines dynamic and static content together and delivers it to the user. One important part here is that we use a VPC, Virtual Private Cloud, which acts as your personal network in AWS. So it's separated from other users in AWS, and this is done via routing. We split the VPC into public and private subnets. We distribute our workload into the availability zones, and these private and public subnets separate our resources from the internet. For example, the load balancer you can see here resides in a public subnet and the Bastion host as well. So you can reach it from the internet. But since the backend application, the database and the EFS are hosted in private subnets, they are not reachable via internet. This is, for instance, a security measurement because you minimize the attack surface to your application. And it becomes easily or more easily manageable in case of access to your system here. One side note about availability zones. We in our system use 3 availability zones. You can only see 2 availability zones here. This is because the diagram would have been even more complex if we put 3 availability zones here. Just imagine that there is another block like this in this diagram. An availability zone is like an independent data center. For example, we host our solution in the Frankfurt region. The Frankfurt region has 3 availability zones. And if one or even 2 availability zones drop because of an internet outage or because they catch fire, which happened to a French hoster last year. I think it was OHS. It would be no problem at all because we still have a third availability zone available. We would still be up and running even if 2 of these data centers, which are called availability zones in AWS, get lost or are not connected anymore. Now we need to find a way to deploy new versions, not only to WordPress, for example, for its plugins, but to the backend application machines as well, because they run, of course, an OS, Ubuntu in this case, and Apache and PHP, and those need security updates and stability updates as well. So someone needs to manage them of course. So let's head over to our deployment. Here we only have highlighted our integral parts of our architecture, which are needed for a deployment. The load balancer is needed, the Bastion host is needed, the admin server is needed, and the template server is needed, as well as the autoscaler, the Aurora serverless, and the EFS web root. We as Toscom, for instance, jump via our Bastion host into our admin machine, which is in a private subnet. And imagine you need a new PHP version. You need PHP 8. How will these backend machines, which can be one machine or 50 machines, get PHP 8? Well, in this case, we deploy the new PHP version to our template machine, and via Terraform, which is an infrastructure as code in our ways, we can then roll out via Terraform the template machines to the autoscaler, which then spawns new versions of PHP 8 flagged application servers to our backends. So these backend application servers, they get switched. And for example, in case of PHP, they would host then PHP 8 instead of PHP 7.4. But not only is Toscom involved in this deployment, because we do the updates, and we do the updates via Terraform, but of course the web developers for WordPress need to update plugins as well. And this is quite easily with this system. This is done quite easily with this system because the backend application server share the same EFS web root. So if you log in at our system to the admin server and update, for instance, a PHP plugin or a plugin like VP Rocket or WooCommerce or whatever you're using, then those updates will reflect in the database, which is shared, and they will reflect in the EFS web, which hosts the web root. So immediately every backend application server gets this new, gets the new data and gets the new version. There is something to note here. In AWS, you have a kind of shared responsibility. So AWS is taking care of your VPC, it's taking care of the data center, it's taking care of the database in this case, of the EFS, of the load balancer, but AWS is not taking care of the machines at the backend application or on a OS level. So they take care, of course, for the hosting, but they don't update your Ubuntu. They don't update the PHP versions. And of course, they don't touch your WordPress. So there's a split between the responsibilities. In this case, if you host a WordPress there, then you have to update the WordPress. We can't update your WordPress for you because we don't have access to the WordPress. Besides, you give us access to the WordPress, then of course. So we manage the machines, you manage the WordPress, and AWS is managing the data centers. Now that we know how to reach and update our WordPress, we need a way to store logs, because logging is quite a hassle at a clustered system like this. Logging is a more complex on clustered environments in comparison to a single server setup. Imagine entering your single server setup and switching to your var log, Apache logs and reading logs, or your WordPress logs and reading logs there. This is this will not work in a setup like this, because one of the reasons is that EFS, which is NFS, but the AWS version of NFS, is not capable of atomic appends. So for example, if a lot of logs get written to the same log files on EFS or NFS, it can happen that those files get corrupted. So in this case, we use FluentD, which grabs the logs from the machines, and FluentD pushes it to Loki, and Grafana is used as a graphical frontend. But this is not the focus of this presentation. But as you can see, logging can become quite a core, or can become quite complicated. On a side note, CloudWatch, S3 and Athena are being used by AWS, and they are quite nicely integrated with the system already, and quite good to use. Now, a burning question, which some of you might have by now, is probably, nice setup, but what does it cost? Well, the costs, it depends. It depends on a lot of different tasks. For example, it depends on your error tolerance. Do you need the application to be in three availability zones, or is one sufficient? Do you need it in only in one region, only in Frankfurt, or do you need a multi-region setup to even have more resilience against outages? Do you need a lot of speed and performance? Do you want the system to be able to handle thousands of requests at the same time, or only tens, or only hundreds? These are things which in AWS you pay as you go, and you pay as you commit to AWS. For example, if you create a system and you don't know how long the system will be running, you would take on-demand instances. But if you know that your new feature, your new WordPress site will be running 2 or 3 years, you could take reserved instances and save a lot of money. One thing here is important. It's the recovery time objective and the recovery point objective. For example, how long can the workload be offline? If you plan on having the workload highly available, and for instance, a whole region gets offline, which with three data centers, which can happen, but it happens very rarely. You could, of course, duplicate your whole setup and host it in another region and do a regional failover. But of course, this can cost a lot more money, because you need every resource doubled. Of course, you can use smaller instances, but it depends on how much time you want to spare to fail over to your new region. Example on how much is a setup like this, how much does a setup like this cost? If you create a setup like we did in this case, and you only have production and no staging environment, it would cost you about 700 euros a month, only for AWS costs. So high availability, high performance costs money, unfortunately. Now to the fun part of my presentation, to the demo. This is a live demo, so I hope everything goes well. I prepared a loader test here for our WordPress. So right now we will be able to run a stress test against the system. We will fire 500 clients per second at our system. It's a GET request on staging.toscom.at, and it will put our little staging system under heavy load. And the test will run about 10 minutes. While the test is running, I will explain to you what we can see here. So keep in mind, we will run 500 clients per second against our system, which is a lot. Imagine your marketing department is not telling you that they started a Black Friday sale, or that you have a huge event coming and no one is telling you as the WordPress developer that this event will come. Then your client launches the event and your web server crashes and you have no idea why. And of course, your client is very unhappy with the hoster. They have put a lot of effort into this event and now the website is down. With AWS and a little bit of thought, you could prevent things like this to happen. For instance, we now have 500 clients per second over 10 minutes. Right now, we have already served 30,000 requests, and our website is still up and running, quite performant and fast. But why does it work this way? Well, we see here that we have currently two web application servers up and running. These are the web application servers which I mentioned before, which have 8 gigabytes of RAM and 4 cores. And those web application servers, they serve those clients quite nicely. But as we can see here at this graph, the CPU utilization goes up. So if we keep on going with 500 clients per second, which is a lot, we will reach 100% CPU utilization shortly. As you know, since Omicron and COVID-19, I think everyone knows how to extrapolate data. Yeah, you can imagine what will happen if we reach 100%. Requests get dropped. So there will be timeouts. There will be people not reaching the website anymore. There will be long loading times. There will be 500 errors, things like that. Now we still can reach the website easily. We still have hundreds and hundreds of requests pouring in. But what will happen if we don't spawn new machines? Those machines will probably die. And we don't want this to happen. So our autoscaler comes in place. We created alarms at our CloudWatch management and integrated those alarms with the autoscaler. So the autoscaler watches the CPU utilization via CloudWatch. And if one of these machines reaches 40% CPU utilization for 2 data points within 2 minutes, a scaling event will occur. So if we keep on watching our live demo pouring in and killing our machines or trying to kill our machines, the autoscaler watches this graph in the background and waits for the CPU utilization to reach 40% over 2 data points within 2 minutes. And if this occurs, new machines will be spawned. And those new machines, of course, can handle even more requests. So if your marketing department talks with you beforehand and says to you, okay, listen, we have a Black Friday sale. We have about 50,000 users coming in. Then of course you can you can just spawn 10 or 20 or 30 machines at once, and they can handle the requests. If your marketing department does not tell you anything about this Black Friday sale, even this architecture has a potential to fail, because it's not instantaneously. We always need a point where we can, which we need to define where the system needs to scale. So if there would come in 50,000 people at once, even this system would crash. If you get told beforehand, you could spawn 100 machines and it won't crash. But in this case, there is a possibility to crash a system like this, even if it's auto-scaled, because it can't handle instantaneous requests. Currently, we are fine though. So the machines can still handle the requests. You can see the CPU utilization is rising. We now have served 150,000 individuals, which is quite a lot. The website is still fast, still up and running, still clickable, can still surf and look at the content. And what we are now waiting for is that our CloudWatch is sending out an alert. Right now we have still the state okay, we still have 2 instances running, but soon there will be an alert. Another thing or another service which is auto-scaled is our database, which we can see here. This RDS CPU utilization is the database CPU utilization. As you can imagine, our landing page staging doscom.at does not trigger a lot of database queries. But in case it happens, this is auto-scaled as well. Keep in mind though that the scaling takes a couple of minutes. So if there is really a lot of burst, like for example, you play an ad on prime time and no one tells you beforehand, this can kill the instances or the database as well. So extreme high loads within short periods of time, it's best to always talk with your host beforehand. Let's look at our alerts. Now it's an alarm. It's an alarm because, as you can see here, the CPU utilization reached already 55%. It reached this. These are two data points within 2 minutes, which are over 40%. So a scaling effect now is in place, and we should see a third instance coming up. As you can see at the status check, it's initializing, and the load balancer, which is handling the requests, waits for this machine to get initialized so it can send requests to this machine as well. This should reflect, after the machine is booted and up and running, into lower CPU utilization on the other machines, of course. Keep in mind that you can decide on how many machines you want to have up and running at once. So you can decide on having a minimum of 3 machines up and running, or you can decide on having, for instance, 10 machines up and running. You can even provide a maximum of machines up and running. So if you don't want more than 4 machines, you can set this up as well. In this case, we don't allow more than 8 machines running simultaneously. We still have a 0% error rate, so this test goes quite well. The website is still reachable. We can still surf on it. We can still look at the content. It's still quite fast. We now have surfed over 250,000 requests. You can see Loader took over 40 gigabytes of traffic. So this is some great example of what a bottleneck your current host could create. It could create bottlenecks on the network interface, for example, because 40 gigabytes is a lot within this period. But it depends on your hoster, of course. So if you have a small hosting, you can reach limits quite easily with such a load of users. Another point why this system is running quite well right now is that the CDN, CloudFront, is caching a lot of the static content, or all of the static content. So VP content, for example, does not get served from these web nodes or the EFS behind it. It gets served from CloudFront, which takes off a lot of load from our system. We can even check this if we look at the developer tools and inspect one of the pictures. Let's look at our precious team. For example, here we can see a cache hit from CloudFront. So this was not served from the EFS or the web server itself. So it was served from CloudFront and took off a lot of load, of course. Now the test has finished. Here we can see at this spike that the new machine has came into place and is active and ready. And immediately the CPU utilization on those two machines have dropped, which was expected, of course, because we have now 3 times the power. And since this onslaught of new connections was still going, the autoscaler even booted the 4th machine. Now, we, of course, have alarms for downscaling as well, because we want to save costs. We don't need 4 machines up and running all the time. So if the CPU utilization on this machines reaches below 50%, or exactly 50% for 3 data points within 3 minutes, these machines get downscaled as well. So we have finished the demo. What are the takeaways? Is this handleable? Is this manageable? Well, we have some pros and cons for a system like this. Let's start with the cons. This setup is complex because cluster setups and multi-environment setups tend to be complex at some point. It creates a larger overhead for you since you need to manage your multi-account setup. You need to manage the access rights. You need to manage a manifold of servers. We at Toscom make it easier for you to manage those, or we manage them for you. But still, if you plan on doing such a setup for yourself, it creates a massive overhead. Debugging can be challenging due to the number of services being used. For example, is there an issue at CloudFront, or is there an issue at your autoscaler, or at the load balancer, or even at WordPress itself, or at the web server? You need to view a lot of logs. You need to know how these systems are integrated and connected together, as well as security issues can arise. If services or access to services are being misconfigured, you may give people access you don't want them to have access. And it can be quite expensive if not used correctly. If you oversize instances, if you oversize your database, if you misconfigure services, it can get quite expensive. The pros, on the other hand, is it's very reliable. Even if availability zones drop or fail, you have an automatic failover or redundancy depending on your setup. It's resilient. If you have a surge on requests, the autoscaler does the rest. As you saw right now, it can handle things like these. It can can't handle bursts, massive bursts, as I said before. It is cost efficient if used correctly. So CloudFront caching, for example, is quite cheap and results in smaller machines because it takes away a lot of load from the machines. Scaling policies help you to reduce the number of machines. For example, you could reduce the number of machines to one overnight because no one is reaching your website overnight. And it's dynamic. You plan a massive sale, no problem. Just spawn 20 more machines and those machines can handle the influx of users. Well, now we reached the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention. I want to give out a special thanks to my colleagues, Christian, Judith, and second Christian. We have three Christians right now at Toscom. It's getting quite complicated. They helped me to do the setup. And if you have any questions or do you plan on creating a scalable WordPress solutions, feel free to contact us. Of course, we will try to answer pending questions right away as well. But here you can see how to reach out to us. Thank you very much.